This video is brought to you by Warby Parker. Order 5 pairs of glasses, try them on for 5 days with no obligation to buy. Head to warbyparker.com/brainfood to try your free home try-on today. More on them in a bit. Eye color is a function of pigmentation both at the back of the iris, iris pigment epithelium, and in its stroma, the front of the iris, as well as the density of cells in the stroma. In most cases, these factors, and hence eye color, are determined by genetics, with potentially as many as 15 different genes identified to date seeming to affect the ultimate coloring in some way. However, contrary to what you might think, blue and green pigments do not exist in the human ocular fluid or iris. In fact, only a couple of pigments are involved in eye color. Those are melanin, brown, and lip chrome, that's yellow. Aside from potential extreme albinism cases, all eyes have some amount of melanin in the back of the iris, although not all eyes have lipochrome. For brown eyes, there is a high concentration of melanin in the back of the iris as well as in the stroma. The result is the melanin absorbing both short and long wavelengths of light from across the visible spectrum, with the density of melanin in these two layers ultimately determining the shade of brown, which in extreme cases can appear near black. On top of the melanin, amber eyes get their eye color from the added presence of lipochrome in the stroma. As we said earlier, blue and green pigments do not play a role in human eye color. So how does anyone have blue or green eyes? Well, the remaining human eye colors, including blue and green, are in part a trick of the light. With blue eyes, there is a fair amount of melanin in the back of the iris, but relatively little melanin within the stroma, making it translucent, with light getting scattered around when it encounters this layer. This scattering occurs more at the shorter wavelengths of light, most relevant here being blue, while longer wavelengths are typically passed through and ultimately absorbed by the melanin at the back of the iris. The net result is the eye appearing blue, even though if you were to dissect the eye in question, you'd see that the person physically had brown eyes. This same type of thing is more or less what's happening in the sky when sunlight is scattered in the atmosphere, making it appear blue, even though if the light from the sun was not being scattered or absorbed in the atmosphere, the sky would look similar to the way it does at night. In the daytime, gray eyes work almost exactly like blue eyes, with a good amount of melanin at the back of the iris absorbing the longer wavelengths, but little within the stroma. The reason these people's eyes don't appear blue is thought to be due to larger deposits of collagen that cause a different kind of scattering that isn't as frequency dependent. This type of scattering is basically what is happening when water droplets in clouds cause them to look some shade of gray. As with blue and gray eyes, there is little melanin in the stroma, and so a bit of light scattering helps impart a blue hue, the net result of all of this being the eye appearing some shade of green. Hazel eyes, which can shift from brown to green, have more melanin in the anterior, front border layer of the eye, and like green, gray, and blue eyes, scatter certain wavelengths of light, resulting in a somewhat shifting eye color. On that note, the fact that these latter hues are largely dependent on a trick of the eye, rather than, for instance, blue pigmentation, is why people with these eye colors sometimes appear to have a different eye color than they normally do. Nothing is actually changed physically in their eyes, but changing the light may end up changing the wavelengths and concentration of light getting scattered and absorbed, resulting in the appearance of, for instance, a normally slightly green eye looking slightly blue. As to why some people have two eye colors, multiple eye colors can be caused by a variety of things, from genetics to various medical conditions such as Horner's syndrome and Waardenburg syndrome. Regardless of the underlying cause, the individuals in question end up with non-uniform distribution of melanin in one or both eyes. In some cases, the individual might have two completely different colored eyes, complete heterochromia. Perhaps the most common cause of this is genetic, however, other phenomena can cause a single eye to completely change color, such as inflammation like that suffered by actress Mila Kunis, which changed the color of one of her eyes. External causes include topical medications used to treat glaucoma, potentially turning a blue eye to brown. Another variation of heterochromia occurs when at least one eye displays two different colors throughout, sometimes with an inner ring differing from the outer coloration, central heterochromia. Another type occurs when only a portion of one eye has a different color. As with more uniform eye coloring, in all cases the resulting eye color is largely a function of brown and yellow pigmentation and its distribution and density in the back of the iris and in its stroma. While this video is all about eyes, and rather appropriately, it's sponsored by Warby Parker, who I want to tell you a bit about before we get into the bonus facts today. I got my try-on box from Warby Parker. It contains 5 glasses that you can try on for 5 days. Obviously, these are not yet to my prescription. I'm going to rotate through these through the rest of this read, and I'll love your feedback on which one you think is right. Pair 1. What you do is you go online and you take a quick quiz and get some recommendations to your face and style. Pair number 2. Glasses start at just $95, including prescription lenses, which is a super competitive price. And you also get all of the good stuff like anti-glare and anti-scratch. Pair number 3, you can even try them on virtually before you get the box if you have an iPhone 10, so that's very cool. Pair number 4, all of these glasses look and feel really great to me, but I'm not a style expert, so let me know, guys, in the comments below what you think. Pair number 5, but yes, Warby Parker, order 5 pairs of glasses and try them on for 5 days, and there's no obligation to buy. This box with all of the sample glasses ships for free, and there's a prepaid envelope in there that you can just post the boxes back in. Head to warbyparker.com/brainfood to get your free home try-on today, and let's get into those bonus facts. Ever wonder why you see random flashes when you rub your eyes? Well, wonder no more. Called phosphenes, these are characterized by perceiving some form of light when there is little or no light actually entering the eye, making it an entropic phenomenon, meaning the source of the phenomenon is within the eye itself. Phosphenes are most commonly introduced by simply closing your eyes and rubbing them or squeezing them shut tightly. Generally, the harder you rub or squeeze, the more phosphenes you'll see. The pressure stimulates the cells of the retina and thus makes your brain think that you are seeing light. Specifically, Grusser et al. Demonstrated that pressure in the eye results in the activation of retinal ganglion cells in a very similar way to how they activate as a response to light. There are also several other ways that phosphenes can be generated. These include through electrical stimulation, intense magnetic fields, hallucinogenic drugs – phosphenes are not to be confused with hallucinations, which are generated in the brain, not the eyes – a blow to the head, or a particularly severe sneeze, where extra pressure is created in the eye on the retina and possible stimulation of the visual cortex. Low blood pressure, which can be experienced if you stand up really fast after you've been relaxing, exposure to radiation, meditation, or extended visual sensory deprivation, various side effects from medical drugs and certain diseases of the retina and nerves. And if you're wondering, the word phosphene was coined by surgeon J.B.H. Savigny, deriving from the Greek phos, meaning light, and phenine, meaning to show. Moving on, have you ever wondered what the stuff in your eyes, commonly called sleep or eye crusties, is when you wake up in the morning? Well, wonder no more. Sleep is a type of rheum, which is the name for discharge from your nose, mouth, or eyes during sleep. More specifically, eye rheum is known as gound. Gound is made up of a mixture of dust, blood cells, skin cells, etc., mixed with mucus secreted by the conjunctiva, as well as an oily substance from the meibomian glands. The meibomian glands are a type of sebaceous glands that line the rim of the eyelids with about 50 on the top and 25 on the bottom of each eye. They secrete an oily substance called meibum that performs a variety of functions, including helping seal your eyes in an airtight fashion when they are closed, preventing tears from spilling onto your cheeks, and helping keep tears that coat your eyes from evaporating. It's this oily substance that is one of the primary components in gowns mixed with mucin from the conjunctiva and various foreign parts. Particles in your eye. Normally, when you are awake, the gound is naturally washed away via tears and the blinking motion. However, when you sleep, you obviously don't blink, so the meibomian secretions and other components of the gound tend to gather in the corners of your eyes, as well as along your eye lines, and then it dries out, creating a hard, yellowish eye booger. So I really hope you found that video interesting. If you did, please do smash that like button below. Don't forget to check out Warby Parker. There is a link to them below. And as always, thank you for watching.